welcome everyone for the electropneumatic video lecture series. So here we are looking at the experiment number 3, that is the hopper control. So the experiment number 3, hopper control, basically is a very simple experiment in which we'll be using a double acting cylinder. So you can either make use of a double acting cylinder or you can make use of a single acting cylinder, but this is one such application where double acting cylinder is very much preferred. So in this case, what we will be doing is we will be actuating the double acting cylinder indirectly. So that will be the basic difference between, you know, earlier experiments what we have seen and this experiment. So the problem description is very simple. So here you can see in this particular positional sketch, you have a hopper. Hopper is basically a container which can store some materials, and the actuator is connected to the hopper with the help of some mechanism, some lever mechanism. So the function of the actuator is to open or either tilt the hopper such that it can empty the contents of the hopper by a push of a button. When you press a button, the actuator should move and it should empty the hopper, the contents of the hopper. And when you press another button, the piston should retract back to its normal position, thereby the hopper returning to its normal position. So this is the basic problem description what we have in front of us. Now for this, let us have a look at the solution. Now, indirectly actuate any system, what we will be doing is we'll be making use of relays. Now relays are very much very helpful. They are basically used for multiple contact points. So indirect actuation of the electropneumatic systems basically actuates the pneumatic systems with the help of relay. So whenever there is a relay, you can easily say that the actuation is indirect in nature. So just to give you an analogy, indirect actuation is something similar to that of pilot operation in the pneumatic system. In pneumatic system, as you might have seen, there is pilot operated ports. The pilot operated ports indirectly operate the valves. So here, instead of pilot operated ports, we have electropneumatically actuated valves. These valves are operated indirectly with the help of relays. Now first let me brief you the pneumatic circuit part. The pneumatic circuit part, as I told you, it can be executed using both single acting cylinder. So this is my single acting cylinder and this is my double acting cylinder. So for now we'll say that we'll be using the double acting cylinder. Now here the circuit is as follows. The air is coming from the compressor and it will go to the air servicing unit. So here it will be filtered and it can be regulated. The output obviously can be given to a manifold. The output of the manifold is given as input to my valve. Now here, if you observe this symbol, this is basically a double solenoid, double-sided solenoid. So here you can see 1Y1 and here it is 1Y2. So here it is solenoid operated on the both the sides. This is 5x2 solenoid operated, that is double solenoid operated direction control valve. In either case, you can see here there is no spring, right? So when you actuate one time, 1Y1 will be activated, or it will be energized. When you press another button, 1Y2 will be energized. So that is how the switching action takes place. Now the output of the valve is given as input to my double acting cylinder. You can see in the double acting cylinder. So initially, by default, the double acting cylinder will be in the retracted position, and the air what is coming from this directly enters the piston side and it will be filling up. As a result, the piston is retracted. The other end, that is the here the piston end, here it is basically exposed to the atmosphere, whereas the rod end is filled with the pneumatic air. When I change the position of the valve using the solenoid, the opposite happens. That is basically the air which is there in the rod end basically gets exposed to the atmosphere, whereas air which will be initially exposed to the atmosphere will be filled, will be filled, that is this portion, that is the piston side, will be filled with the pneumatic air. And once the piston side is filled with the pneumatic air, obviously there is extension. So here the piston extends, and whatever air that is present here will get exhausted. So that is the basic operation. So this is the pneumatic part of it. Now if we see the electrical part of it, so here this is where things starts to get interesting. So the electrical part of it, we can see the electrical circuit diagram. Now in this circuit diagram we have introduced two new symbols. So here you can see K1 and K2, this rectangle symbol, this K1 and K2 are nothing but relays. So these are the symbols used for relay. Now the way we are going to operate the electrical pneumatic system is basically we'll be sending input to our relays, and the relay will in turn energize. This energizing of relay basically in turn will closes the relay contact. So here you can see K1 is the relay, and the normally open contact of relay K1 is shown here, right? So this is K1, that is the relay. The contact point associated with relay K1, that is the normally open type contact point, is represented here. So that is in turn given as output, as the input to my 1Y1 solenoid. So when K1 is energized, the normally open type contact will close, right? So this is why this is known as indirect actuation. I could have directly used the switch S1 and given power to the solenoid. So that is direct actuation. So here I'm not doing that. What we did in experiment 1 and 2 was that direct actuation. So now I'm energizing relay K1. In turn, K1 will change the contact point. Initially normally open will become normally closed. It will become closed. And once it is closed, 1Y1 energizes. 1Y1 energizes basically means it will actuate the cylinder. The same happens for the switch S2 also. S2 is another push button switch. When S2 is closed, K2 is another relay. K2 gets energized. When K2 gets energized, there will be a switching of the contact points. So the K2 contact point, which is normally open contact point, gets closed when K2 is energized. So this will get closed when relay K2 is energized. When this happens, naturally 1Y2 will receive the power, and this will be energized, and the actuation of the solenoid 1Y2 takes place, and accordingly there will be movement of the cylinder. So this is the electrical portion of the circuit. So we are going to execute this. Design the electrical circuit on the workstation, then we will look into the pneumatic part, and then we'll combine both. So let's see. Okay. In this, first let us make the electrical connections, then we will look into the pneumatic portion. Just to take you back to the circuit, so here we have the indirect actuation of the double acting cylinder. So this is the indirect actuation, as you can see. So here we'll be using relays K1 and K2. So these were not used in earlier experiments. So in order to use K1 and K2, first we need to give power supply to the boards which is having the relays. So that is where we'll come back to this portion, this boards. So as I mentioned earlier, the electropneumatic portion has three boxes. One is power supply. This box basically controls the input, that is switches and the lamps, etc. Whereas the third box is where you will find relays. You can see these are the relays, right? A1, A2 are the contact points of the relays. So here you have maximum three relays. So for our experiments, we need only two relays. So we'll say that this is K1, whereas this is K2. Right. First, let us give connections, that is power supply, to the board number 3. So here I'm just going to short this so that there is flow of current, and then also I will short the ground. So this ground is connected to this. Now you can see the power is flowing from this main supply to this and back to this. So there is connection. So now we need to use two switches. So S1 is the switch. So we'll follow the same procedure what we followed in the earlier experiments. So I'm going to take 24 volts, which is coming. Let us say this is my S1 and this is S2, right? So this is S1, this is S2. So I'm just going to give this to connect the terminal 1-3, right? That is normally open. So 1-3 is the switch S1 contact point. Now the output of that is given as input. So the output is this. This is given as input to my K1 terminal, right? So just you can see this in the circuit diagram, right? So this is my 1-3. So from 24 volts, I gave it to 1-3, and then you have 1-4. 1-4, I am connecting it to the terminal. So let us say this is A1, right? So the other one is A2, right? This is 1-4 is given to A1. Now the A2 has to be grounded. So I'm just taking this A2 of relay K1 and grounding it. I'm just connecting it, right? So this completes the first line of the circuit, right? This completes the first line of the circuit. So now we'll repeat the same for the switch S2. So again, I will take one more output from 24 volts. Now this is my S2. I'll connect it to 1-3. So this is 1-3. Right, the output of that S2 switch, that is 1-4, I am just giving it to K2 A1, right? I'm giving it to K2 A1. The output of that K2, in other words, that A2 terminal is grounded. So I'm just shorting this. So this is grounded, right? So this completes the first relay portion. So what we have done now is taken 24 volts, we have given it to 1-3, and then 1-4, this we have given A1, this we have given to A2, this we have completed. Now we can just at this point, we can check whether the relay is getting energized or not. So we can just go back to the electrical circuit. Okay, so here, let us see whether our connections are proper or not. So mind you, this is S1, this is S2. When I press S1, K1 should energize. And when I press S2, K2 should energize. So let us see. So you can see K1, the light is on, right? K1 light is on. When I press S2, K2 light is on, right? So the relays are getting the power. Now, we need to make use of the contact points of the relay and then give that output to my the wall, right? So for this, what I want is we will be using 5x2 double solenoid operated direction control valve. So this we have not used earlier experiments. We have used only single solenoid operated valve. So here you can see solenoid is there in the both sides. So in other words, there is no spring, right? I'm just going to mount it like this, right? So now first complete the electrical portion. So what we have left now is, let us again go back to the circuit diagram here. So again, let us have a look at the circuit diagram. So this is again my 24 volts. So the 24 volts has to, the one of the normally open, right? So this is NO. Normally open contact of K1 should receive 24 volts. And the output of that should go to the solenoid 1Y1, which is the input to the wall. So first let us complete this. So we are familiar with the K1. So this is my K1. So we can see these dotted lines. These dotted line indicates they are all the contact points of the K1. So what we now need is normally open contact, right? So normally open contact is this. Now this is where the things starts to get a little bit tricky. So here this has to be first connected to power supply, which is 24 volts. Now
this is getting 24 volts.
The output of that, the output of the relay contact K1, which is this, has to go as input to my solenoid 1Y1. So this is the input 1Y1. And the ground, that is 0 of 1Y1, has to be grounded, so we can just connect it to any one of those points, grounding points. Similarly, repeat the same procedure. So first, let us take the contact point K2. So this is my relay K2. The normally open contact of K2 has to be first receiving 24 volts. So I'm just going to connect this to 24 volts. The output of that K2, which is this, has to go as input to my 1Y2. So this is 1Y2. And the other end is grounded. So this is grounded. Right? So this completes the electrical part. So if you want, you can just check whether your circuit is working or not. So when I press S1, 1Y1 should get power. When I press S2, 1Y2 will receive power. So this is happening indirectly. In other words, when I press S1, K1 gets energized. Then K1 in turn will send the power to 1Y1. So that is why it is called indirect. And similarly, S2, when I press, S2 energizes K2. K2 in turn will basically give the output to my 1Y2. So just have a look at this. You know, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to press the switch push button S1. So when I'm pressing S1, K1 is actuated. When K1 is actuated, you can see the wall. So here 1Y1 is also getting actuated. So I'm going to press S2 now. S2 in turn actuates K2. K2 in turn will actuate my 1Y2. You can see the light. So the electrical circuit is working properly. Next we'll connect the pneumatic part. So the pneumatic portion is very simple. So I'm taking the output that is coming from my manifold. I'm giving input to the 5x2 direction control valve. So this input is there. The output, that is port 4, I'm giving as input to double acting cylinder. And the other output, port 2, is connected to the double acting cylinder. So this is the pneumatic portion. So once this is done, I'm just going to switch on. You can see now the pneumatic portion is active. Electrical portion is also active. Now you can see the interaction between electro pneumatics. So I'll press S1. When I press S1, K1 energizes, then K1 in turn energizes 1Y1. 1Y1 in turn will push the valve. This will basically make the actuator to move forward. Right? So you can see the moment I release it, since this is not a spring return type of valve, it will remain in that particular position itself. So for making sure this has to retract, I have to press S2. So when I press S2, S2 will actuate the energized relay K2. K2 will in turn energizes 1Y2, and this will in turn return back. So this is proper control.